Brooklyn has been a melting pot in America's cultural society for centuries. In the early 1900s, Brooklyn was a vibrant, booming borough. As it expanded, trolley lines were built, subways were constructed, and urbanization of the borough rapidly continued. By 1930, more than 60% of the African Americans in Brooklyn had been born outside of the borough. The stock market crash in 1929 tore down hopes for a prosperous life. Brooklyn helped to supply the manufacturing needs of the country. By the end of the 40s, Brooklyn's industrial success began to stutter. Big manufacturers began to move to cheaper locations in other cities, and the ports became less active as big container ships requiring deep harbors began to control the shipping trade. Growing poverty and the easy availability of government-sponsored housing loans sparked the middle classes to leave their former neighborhoods, and they flocked to the suburbs. Once vibrant neighborhoods fell into despair, decay, and poverty. Industrial activity fell by one half from 1954 and 1990. Regardless of the crime and conflict of the 1970s and early 80s, the final decade of the 20th century witnessed a revival in Brooklyn's neighborhoods. Crime slowed down during the 1990s, and neighborhoods like Brooklyn Heights, Fort Greene, and Clinton Hill began to spring back to prosperity. After these neighborhoods started to come back to a time of economic succession, much more followed over time, such as Park Slope, Bed-Stuy, Gowanus, and other neighborhoods. That was Brooklyn then, but much more Brooklyn has changed.
Gentrification is the process by which more affluent people move into poorer neighborhoods and over time change the property values and culture of that neighborhood.
When it comes to gentrification, I think it's one thing that's definitely difficult to talk about with children, but it's this idea of like, where are you spending your money? Because gentrification can lead to having more things in the community, and that's not necessarily a bad thing, right? Like, if a new coffee shop opens down the street, like, that's great, I like coffee. But I think where it becomes an issue is when you have people that become displaced, right? You have people that have been living in this community for a long time, and now because there are other businesses moving in, or there are other renters moving in, you have people that are then forced out of their community. And so I think that's really the issue with gentrification. Not so much that we have, you know, healthier, trendier food, not so much that we have more expensive food, but I think when it comes to people losing their homes, that's when it becomes a really big problem.
I think gentrification is scary. I live in a very gentrified neighborhood, and it's hard to live in here because I have a really safe home where I am with my family. I have a roof over my head. I have food. And when I walk out my door, I don't always feel safe, or I can hear sort of a lot of privilege outside the door.
This was a predominantly African-American, Latino community, and it was not as vibrant in terms of the shops and things that existed, and the cost of living was much cheaper.
In Brooklyn today, middle-income to low-income families living in lower-class neighborhoods do not have healthy food such as fruits and vegetables accessible to them, especially organic ones. They are expensive and sometimes hard to come by. More junk foods, such as potato chips, soda, candy, and fast food, are made cheap and accessible to communities in Brooklyn, such as Flatbush, Fort Greene, Canarsie, and East New York, as well as other communities. Not only are there communities without healthy food options, there are neighborhoods being gentrified, whose food options are made more expensive by the increase in rent. Partially, as well as other factors, farmers markets in Brooklyn that sell locally grown organic products. Unfortunately, most of these markets are located in wealthier neighborhoods and are priced highly. These options target the wealthier and ignore others who possibly need food even more than those who are purchasing it. However, there are a few exceptions. The Park Slope Food Co-op is a local food market that exchanges members' working hours for organic food that they say is cheaper than most farmers' markets.
40 years, but no, the co-op was targeted towards members or people who wanted to get quality food at cheap prices. And they come from all over the country and all over the world. We have a membership that is international. And we have members that travel here from great distances to buy food.
I joined because I wanted to be a part of my community, and I just think this co-op does important work making healthy food more available to a broader community, so I wanted to be a part of that.
It's definitely more fresh, kind of feels straight from the farm. The price is lower because you work shifts to pay, you know, a lesser price. Everybody shares the responsibility of running the store. And it's great to feel like you're part of the community. I meet a lot of people here.
And part of our reason why our prices are be able to keep so low is that our members make an agreement that they're willing to work for food. And they put in 2 3/4 hours every 4 weeks, every 28 days, and that helps to keep our overhead or our labor prices very low.
Piece of personal activism around food justice, and currently healthy food is only accessible to a small demographic. It's expensive and more than just money, but time is a factor, so fast food options are, if you're working two shifts and have lots of people to feed, that's going to be your best option. So I believe that the food system needs to be restructured so that it's equitable for everybody.
A place where they grow natural products in Brooklyn is the Botanical Gardens. Their institute stretches across multiple neighborhoods. We got the opportunity to talk to a few workers who worked at the Botanical Gardens. A report from AM New York in February of 2016 stated that Brooklyn is the most expensive place to live in all of America. For some low-income Brooklyn natives, they can barely even afford to live off a diet of unhealthy products, let alone ones that are nutritious. Healthy food is not being bought in the projects because it's either too expensive, too far away, or it's unappealing to the residents for a number of possibilities.
I think that food, like many things in this country, has been really racialized, and I think that healthy food has been equated to whiteness in this country. I think that when I work with young people especially, I'll be talking about anything green and they say they don't like it or they don't want to try it, or I've been asked to do recipes that have less vegetables or are more traditional, and then I will go back to some of the cookbooks and talk to some of our ancestors and see that they've been cooking with green things and vegetables forever, and that is what has been sustaining our people, and that our cuisines have really been narrowed down to, I'll use the Puerto Rican experience, just a handful of dishes of arroz con gandules, arroz con habichuela, lechon, mofongo, when really there are hundreds of dishes in our cuisines, and cuisines are created from people constantly being artists. And when you don't have the ingredients and the access to food to be an artist and be creative with your food, we're no longer able to create and nourish ourselves in the same way. So I think that healthy food has been equaled to white, which it is not. I think that people of color, and especially young people, and I include myself in that, we've been sort of taught that our food is not healthy. And I think that that's really, really saddening. Breaks my heart.
Then there were DVD stores, there were more diners, and there were definitely less real estate places. There was a bakery, I remember, called Regina's Bakery. There was even a fruit stand on top of my block. And over time, there's been more phone stores that have popped up, more real estate stores, and more just gentrification. It's definitely less diverse now.
I usually go to like Japanese restaurants, sometimes Mexican restaurants. I don't know, I just like eating like all types of food, so I don't really have a specific type, but I usually spend like over $10. Which is a lot of money, actually.
Pretty much, I think if people from a lower income bracket purchase the food, they're probably making a sacrifice, but they are health conscious and they do want it. So pretty much, I think it's important that it's accessible to everyone, but definitely price point does play a big part in people's decision on purchasing organics.
There are many factors making it hard for people to stay eating nutritious food. For people who don't have motivation to eat well and don't have the motivation to have their family eat well, use this film as your motivation. If all you have is the place you're living inside of, grow produce out of pots. Whatever way you can access good food, do it. We must empower good, healthy living in order to continue positive, natural ways in life, in order to stay in touch with our culture, our ancestors, our past, our present, and our future. This is my food. This is my Brooklyn. You was my right when push came to shove. One what? One love. One love. One love.
Stay strong. Out in New York, the same thing is going on.
Greatness.
What do you ignore?
The heavy things.
Why?
Because there's no use crying over spilled milk.
Made my dream come true. Let's do this. Let's get it. I'm ready to get this money. Who's ready to get this money? I'm ready to get this money. Are you ready to get this money?